Joe, I tried to think back to what it was that I was doing back in 1998, mm-hmm. and I believe most of it was using dial-up internet. I was getting knuckle deep into the N64, which mm-hmm. is not sexual, by the way. Not sexual.
No, not at all. Yeah. It's just a small controller hits the knuckles.
Yeah. Exactly. What I wasn't doing, though, was watching films that centered on kaiju that were from years past. Although I had mm-hmm. I had read some of these like adapted Godzilla books, picture books, and stuff like that.
Oh yeah,
mm-hmm. But never really got into it. And
well,
yeah,
it is Godzilla, like in the kaiju genre, is something that was very different for Americans as opposed to being in Japan. Like I know, like I was encapsulated from the first time I had like seen like the 1954, like what is actually a very terrible bastardization of the movie. And it was Godzilla King of the Monsters, and it's literally whittled down to like fucking 75 minutes of film. Because oh when the original one from the 50s is very, very anti-nuclear attacks, kind of heavy in the America did this to us sort of thing. And believe it or not, Hollywood's like, that probably won't fly here, but we do love monsters right now. So we're going to knock out basically all of the hard-hitting message and theme you have of this and just have an American journalist talking to people in Japan while the monster comes. People will love it. And it kind of worked in the United States. It really didn't. So you basically had people who really liked that original film and then got nothing for a really long time. But meanwhile, Mark, and here's a fun little thing to try and do for some trivia. Before this Godzilla movie in 1998, how many Godzilla movies do you think there were?
Oh, man. I don't know if I'm educated enough to answer this question. I think mm-hmm. maybe three? I don't know.
You would be off just a little bit. Now, if we exclude Godzilla King of the Monsters and we go solely just Gojira all the way up to 98 in America, and just looking at the Japanese films, 23.
Okay. Jesus.
23 Godzilla movies.
Yeah, stretch that one out.
Yeah, they did. And actually, he got a reboot in there, Mark, because you had 15 in the Showa era, which run from 54 into like the late 70s. And then Godzilla like takes a break through like half of the 80s and comes back in 84 and makes it for another decade into 94 or maybe 95, where you get the last of the Heisei era Godzilla movies, which of course they were seven Heisei Godzilla movies.
But so you're not counting the North Korean made Bulgasari movie, are you?
I am not counting that one, even though that was made by the same filmmakers, and that has its own crazy ass bizarre history. If you ever look into it, like it is nuts. The making of that movie, like the director basically gets like trapped in North Korea and can't go back to Japan. It's wild, Mark.
We're laughing about it now, but it's very serious what happened to this poor guy.
It was,
oh,
yeah. Jeez. But meanwhile, for us here in the States, we didn't really get much of that at all. We missed out on a ton until I think it's somewhere in, I want to say, like right around when the Heisei era ends in 94, Columbia TriStar gets the rights to distribute Godzilla to the West, where they mm-hmm. do a lot of those really bad dubs that we know so much about, where we like to make fun of the how the like nothing matches up to the mouths of the actors. A lot of it comes from there. And this is where I thrived as a small child, is watching these dubs and not even caring that nothing matched up to their lips because they were giant monsters, Mark.
That's what we spent most of our mm-hmm. our early lives in like middle school making fun of, was when we would make fun of Godzilla, we would all do the mouth mm-hmm. movement things where clearly we're not saying what you mm-hmm. think we are. And that was really my mm-hmm. the height of my exposure at this point in time. But what's funny about when this hits the Americas, though, We've been inundated with a certain kind of movie across the early 90s into the mid 90s. And we call these Roland Emmerich joints, which, I mean, I think we all remember where we were when we watched Independence Day. And then later we'd sidle into 2012 and Day After Tomorrow. And and Roland Emmerich really became known as the master of disaster, right? Like he just honed the disaster film quite a bit. And for the 90s, what that meant was, yes, explosions, but it also meant we can solve marital problems, sibling rivalries, business issues, international espionage, all that stuff can be solved by these harrowing events.
Yes, these large disasters that pull us together. And, you know, he had such a handle on the genre that literally when they were making Independence Day, Will Smith just is like, all right, when you want me in the recording studio, I'll make a song. And he's like, no, we don't need that for this. Yeah. Will Smith was completely taken aback. He's like, you don't need me to make a song for the movie I'm in? I mean, I don't think you are aware of this, but it's usually the best part of the movie and it kind of carries it. But if you're confident, I'll roll with it. And it worked. We didn't need a Will Smith track for this movie. For Independence Day, not Godzilla. Will Smith is not attached to this movie whatsoever. No.
No.
And speaking of the lead up to this movie, Mark, do you remember the hype for this movie at all? Do you remember any of the 90s like pump up advertising that would lead to this movie?
Now, this is a blind spot for me from a pop culture perspective, but I do remember that the ad campaign for, like, because this was something I actually heard about in college, was that the ad campaign for it was like strikingly well done. There's a ton of great tie-ins and limited time, like cups and all kinds of things. But I don't know specific details, though. It's been a while.
It was absolutely legit. And eventually it does get made, like the overall production and everything does get made fun of in a commercial we'll get to later. But like you said, there are tie-ins everywhere. One of the most notable ones was with Taco Bell. And at the time of the 90s, do you remember the Taco Bell spokesman?
The Chihuahua.
The talking Chihuahua. He was like trying to catch Godzilla with a box and a taco and a stick and a string. Then he realized he was going to need a much bigger box. And they did all of this stuff where you never saw Godzilla. You only would see a foot at a time to realize that this is going to be a different looking Godzilla than we've ever gotten before. And they were also going toe to toe with the sequel to Jurassic Park, The Lost World at this time. And one of the brilliant things that they did to advertise this was a movie of like a middle school field trip through a museum where all the kids are really bored. They get to the T-Rex and they kind of yawn because they've seen a T-Rex skeleton out of nowhere. And then the whole museum starts shaking. And the next thing you know, Godzilla's foot crashes through the museum and crushes the T-Rex skeleton. Like, they went like above and beyond advertising this movie. And again, like the smartness of never really showing us Godzilla the entire time, because the poster is again just his foot among really tall buildings. So it's again like you're just like a mystery of like, or the eye, that's right, you get just enough to keep you interested but not enough that you know what's going on. And it was the same with the trailers. And this was also a time when they made things just for a trailer that never show up in the movie. Because again, that museum scene, nowhere in this movie. So they had hyped this up a ton. And then, of course, spoiler alert, pretty big letdown overall. Not a lot of people happy with this movie. And then eventually you get, I forget what the commercial's actually for. I will find it eventually and have it playing like right here.
All right, people. What do you got?
Death Slug. Big lizards are out.
Nice. Action figure.
It's big, squishy, and it leaves a slime trail.
Nice. Kidney meal.
The slug taco. Put salt on it. It shrivels.
Nice. Music video?
We call it Slug Slide.
Nice. What else?
Slug slippers.
Nice.
Slug slush.
Nice.
Slug on a stick.
Nice. What about the movie?
Well, we don't have a script yet, but we can bang one out by Friday.
Nice.
This summer, don't buy the hype. Buy what you want.
Is that this hype was so very real, there was so much effort put into it, that you got a lot of people to see this movie and got a lot of people leaving feeling kind of dissatisfied.
I was going to say, we might as well dive right into what we've been doing with films this year, which is, what did the people think, which was the critics and the moviegoers? And critics hated this film, Joe. It's a 19% on Rotten Tomatoes. Audiences were not that far behind them at 28%. I mean,
honest question. Is this the worst movie we've ever talked about on the podcast?
Well, it could very well be. And let's go to the actual words of the critics here. Let's just see what they've had to say about this. I know that we usually do like bad, neutral, good. I want to reverse that. We'll start off with the positive first, okay?
Did you find the one positive review out there?
I found the one. I didn't even have to go to page 10. It was on the front.
Ooh.
And this person, this poor bastard, whoever they are, he said, this is damn good aesthetic amusement. It's Aliens, and it's Jurassic Park, and it's Starship Troopers. It's what we get now, and maybe we should be thankful for the simplification.
He likes a movie you don't have to think about, is what he's saying. It's a movie, and they made it. Watch it. It's good.
So whoever that person is, let's just make sure there's not a methane leak where they watch the film.
Oh, man.
The neutral one is actually kind of humorous. It would be fun to report that Godzilla is a 400-foot-tall turkey in lizard's clothing, but the truth is it's just rather dull. Once again, I'm finding a hard time disagreeing with what I've read here. The truly, truly negative here is that character counts and Godzilla is a negative number. They're not wrong. They're not wrong at all.
No.
It's widely regarded as one of the biggest box office bombs of the 90s. And that's despite making $379 million against a box office budget of an estimated $150 million, which if you double that number, I'm guessing with the marketing campaign, Joe, they easily spent that much on tie-ins.
They probably did. And at least, like, maybe it was because, like, okay, they were like, here's the deal, guys. We've watched the movie. Not good. We're going to do everything we can to hype it and hopefully break even on this thing.
Yeah.
And, like, they had plans for a sequel for this movie. It didn't happen. The closest it got was an animated series on Fox. To the credit, actually, a solid animated series. I actually thoroughly enjoyed it. And that was like the same studio that gave us like Extreme Ghostbusters and Men in Black. It was a very, very, like, oddly, just a big flash in the pan studio that made a lot of stuff in the mid to late 90s and then just disappeared. Did
a lot
nothing.
Of tie-ins.
But
yeah.
I think what we have to do is we have to dial this back. And I'm going to say this right now. We've been really hitting hard how much this movie, not great so far in the podcast. That being said, please don't leave yet. Because like anything, we would like you to hear what we have to say, figure out what's kind of going on with this movie, and then go watch it yourself. Maybe it's been a minute since you've seen it, and you're like, is it as bad as I remember it being, and I'll watch it again? Or maybe you've never seen it because you've never given giant lizards a chance before, in which case, give this one a chance, and then don't give up. Please don't give up on the giant lizards after you watch this movie.
At least get your friends together and have a few drinks and just laugh your ass off, right? Like, I think that's at minimum what you can do with this film. But I think it would be a good place to start, as we typically do, is to start to talk about who some of the players are in this film. Because, I mean, Joe, I can think of a handful of Matthew Broderick movies that I actually return to. And admittedly, I had never seen this film before you suggested it, which I feel like now I have to ask why. But really, Matthew Broderick is leading this thing, and mm-hmm. I kind of feel like he proved why he shouldn't lead action films by doing this.
It's because he's not like, again, it's kind of weird in that, like, he's the star of an action movie and the character inherently isn't an action person because he's playing Nick Titopoulos, who shares a last name with, I think, one of the producers of this movie. If you watch the opening credits, you will see a Titopoulos in there. And I forgot to look into that as we were preparing for this. And it's a kind of a running joke that no one can pronounce his name properly. So I usually just default to calling him the worm guy because he is studying earthworms in Chernobyl and what effect the radiations has had on them. So he's a nerd. And I don't know if they're kind of going for this whole, like, let's make the nerd the hero, the sort of thing. But that's what they tried. I guess at least like you said, like, he's not an action star. But do you feel like they tried making an action star in this? Because, like, me looking back and watching this, he just doesn't have a lot of action sequences that are like, oh, look, I've suddenly stepped up to the occasion. It's kind of a fumbling through things for the most part for him.
It's really hard to say that any character in this movie really did much of anything, because this is one of those rare movies where, like, mm-hmm. at least in, okay, let's look at Emmerich's other work, like, at least in Independence Day, there is enough character development to kind of show you what each little pod of people kind of focuses mm-hmm. on. And there's enough character development to really drive that stuff home. In this movie, like, Matthew Broderick's character, all you really know is he's studying shit outside of Chernobyl. You don't really know a whole lot else about him. And we get very little context as we go. And mm-hmm. to your point, it's like, yeah, let's just write this baby in a couple of days and get it over with.
Yeah, he's a pretty flat character, right? Like, he doesn't change much. We see just basically he is enthusiastically confused through a good chunk of the movie.
Yeah.
And not to say that he's like adult. He's educated, but at the same time, always kind of surprised that he's right, sort of thing, with what he's doing here. And we see that, and then he is angry for all of 3 minutes in this movie. And it's hard to believe that he's angry. He should be angry, but it's hard to, like, just, he doesn't come off as actually angry. And it's hard to see him that way.
He's not mad. He's disappointed. You know, just like, yes, just like most parents.
He's a dad without kids or a wife.
Yeah.
He's a dad. Mm-hmm.
But
as I say, in the action-y realm, we do have one, I guess, quasi-action star who's been in at least one action movie before this. From Leon the Professional, we have the leading man, Jean Reno, who also, going to throw out there, for years, I put him on every, like, work application, job application I've ever turned in. And just wrote Jean Reno actor.
Yeah.
Only one person actually recognized him, which is actually kind of sad. And he asked if I actually knew him. I'm like, nah, I thought it would look good.
Yeah.
I got that job too, by the way. It was a car detailer in Minnesota. So here is Jean Reno, who gets to be French, his own nationality. And he turns out to be not the insurance salesman or insurance company he claims to be in the movie, but is actually from the French Secret Service. Mm-hmm. And their goal is to try and clean up after their country's shortcomings with nuclear testing, as he is going around trying to cover up Godzilla so that no one knows that Godzilla is doing things. And he continues to do so after we're well aware that Godzilla is doing things. So I'm not sure. That's where his character gets confusing. Like, he's believable all the way until everyone knows there's a giant lizard in a big city. And he's still, like, taking people's tapes so people can't see what's going on. He's trying to cover things up. It's like, dude, Jean, we know. It's hard to miss.
There's a reason why he can't cover it up, though. Mm-hmm. It's because he's got Maria Patillo, who is mm-hmm. Matthew Broderick's something ex-wife, ex-girlfriend, ex-lover.
Yeah, former lover, just ditched him at the end of college.
We're not really quite sure because nobody's really told us, and there's no way to find out. That's just kind of how this movie's written. but she's, well,
they do explain that in the movie. They went out in college, and then she just ends up chasing her career in New York and leaves Matthew Broderick's character behind. And that's where we eventually pick things up.
Mm-hmm. This is that opportunity where you could go, all right, let's actually show Matthew Broderick thinking mm-hmm. about this thing rather than just going, oh, suddenly he's got a dozen pictures still of her in his work cubicle. It's mm-hmm. like they had an opportunity here, but regardless, the rest of the cast of this movie mm-hmm. feels like NPCs for disaster films. Now, we've had Kevin Dunn as an actor on several episodes of other movies, so mm-hmm. we know who Kevin Dunn is. He's fantastic. We love Kevin Dunn.
Yeah.
He predicted mm-hmm. the end of the world, so...
He did.
he's good.
Valentine's Day.
Mm-hmm. Absolute bummer, but mm-hmm. one thing that I think people will notice, or maybe they don't, is that Dean Devlin, who helped write this movie, was a huge mm-hmm. Simpsons fan, and he managed to pull Hank Azaria, Harry Shearer, and Nancy Cartwright mm-hmm. into this film, which for me is like mm-hmm. it's breaking. Like, it breaks me every time I see them, because like Hank Azaria, don't get me wrong, dude, I've seen him in mm-hmm. There's a movie called Shattered Glass that had Hayden Christensen and a mm-hmm. bunch of really good actors in it. Great film, and Hank Azaria appears in that too. He yep. is a damn good actor.
if you've never given Brockmire a go, it's a fun series about a very drunk baseball announcer.
Yes.
Great time with Hank Azaria. But yeah, like you said, he is someone who you kind of wish, for his resume's sake, didn't get stuck in this movie. Because, like, I don't know, to his credit, his character is very much the stereotype of every New Yorker wrapped into one. Of what you have here. And he's got some fun lines, and like one that I will use every once in a while is when I try to get someone to go out and do something with me. I'm like, come on, it'll be fun. Is what he says when he's trying to sneak into a quarantine zone. And I get it from this movie. So like he has his moments. If you enjoy Hank Azaria, you will enjoy him in this movie, because like he does everything he can to make his character work.
Mm-hmm. So for me, Joe, first time watching this movie, watching the opening sequence, I couldn't help but try mm-hmm. to compare it to other movies that seemingly start off okay and then mm-hmm. never manage to start running. It's just stumbling, right? And mm-hmm. this one was reminiscent of like Wolverine Origins, where you have this like fairly well put together intro mm-hmm. that kind of sucks you in. You're seeing things that maybe you don't quite have full context of. We're seeing a ton of iguanas, and I was like, okay, all right, you know what? I'm coming in fresh. You're right. You know, mm-hmm. I'm like Frank Costanza. I don't want any context whatsoever.
No, and so these iguanas are watching nuclear explosions go off. And honestly, it would have been totally fine if while they're watching it, because they're just staring directly at the blast. Like they probably shouldn't. You shouldn't. Yeah. It's like, you know, looking at the sun, you don't do it. And I'd have been totally fine if at one point in time, like they would just have like flipped on sunglasses and just kept on staring. Mm-hmm. Would have been okay. Would have taken nothing away from the movie.
Yeah. Just say deal with it and have it mm-hmm. slowly slide down over their eyes. I mean, that's fine with me.
Mm-hmm.
What I thought was a good choice was the intro, though, where you see this boat with a ton of fishermen mm-hmm. on it. They're chopping up fish. They're just kind of doing their own thing. And it's dark. It's kind of mm-hmm. stormy. It kind of has this like horror vibe to it, kind of, you know. And that's the first time we see Gojira, at least.
Yeah.
You know, claws and feet,
bits and pieces. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the telltale large blip mm-hmm. moving towards the other blip on the radar.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Classic action tropes, man.
Oh, they're great. And this is where like it's kind of leading us from all that hype advertisement we had been getting for the months leading up to this movie. is like, hey, they're doing the same thing. Like, we saw little glimpses. It's what we've been seeing in the trailers. This is why we're at this movie. And like you said, it's got a right amount of like horror going on, a right amount of like just like fun going. It's doing a good deal of foreshadowing because obviously the nuclear explosions, the iguanas, the fish, these are all things that are key to the movie moving forward. And I actually believe, I want to say that this is right, that the name of the fishing vessel that's there is the Lucky Dragon 5, which, if it is, that is a callback to the original Godzilla or the Gojira movie, which that is the name of the first ship that gets destroyed and set on fire by a flash of atomic energy from Godzilla. So they're doing little things like paying homage to the original movie. Right now, as it is, this is doing everything a good movie should be doing. And then it stops doing all those things.
And then we careen back into like early 90s shit where, mm-hmm. you know, things are going great. Although Matthew Broderick can't seemingly do a film without singing, which he's clearly yep. doing. Got a call back mm-hmm. to Broadway and all of his stage work. But then the military sweeps in. We get our standard, you've been reassigned. And it's Hello. Like, okay. Ooh.
Spooky government military, here we go.
Yeah, but it's like, we have satellite phones, y'all can talk. I mean, it's the late 90s. You don't need to have yeah. a guy come out in a massive helicopter, but whatever. No. Mm-hmm. That's what they're doing. Yeah. yeah. But
it's slower. Yeah. It takes more resources. Why not give it a try that way?
I mean, it looks good on film, I guess. But mm-hmm. he's immediately pulled out of this little Chernobyl worm-digging experiment that he's doing, which, believe it or not, will come in handy later. Which mm-hmm. we will talk about later.
Yeah.
But mm-hmm. we don't spend a ton of time here. We get to see a massive footprint in the ground that is mm-hmm. oddly perfectly shaped and moves us right into Audrey Timmons, though. Classic 90s mm-hmm. woman. I feel like in the 90s, they just did this in movies where they're like, we have to show a woman constantly struggling. She's always got a yes. bag of groceries mm-hmm. for some reason. She's mm-hmm. late for something.
Can't make it to the elevator. Like, mm-hmm.
yeah, hold that elevator. It's like this was the only way they knew how to write women back then. And mm-hmm. and I was watching it going, I don't feel like she's that badly put together. But this trope, no. once again, mm-hmm. it's like they had a template for this.
Yeah. And I have to say, if there is any part of this movie, there's an absolute, like, if you had no idea what life was like in the 90s and what we were doing in there. You could look at Maria Patillo and her character, along with her friend, who is Hank Azaria's wife, and they are the 90s, with their style, their hair, the way they talk to each other. Everything is exactly what women wanted to be in the 90s in this time. And Hank Azaria is kind of the dude version, where he's got the leather coat with the big lapels going for him. He's got his stylish hat that looks like, you know, Frank Sinatra had it. And then on top of that, Matthew Broderick has like the, I don't know, I feel like it's the Newsies hat, but it's backwards. Yeah. I've never been into that hat. But that's what we have here is like a biggest thing. Like, I mean, they're both wearing like, these are two women working in a newsroom, and like they're in like fluorescent color tops that are mid-drift down. They're tied together in the middle. It is just 90s. Perfectly right there. The only thing that was missing would be like baggy basketball jerseys. No one had one of those in this movie. But you know, you can't do everything.
And speaking of not being able to do everything, we do get some pretty questionable CGI right away without even looking mm-hmm. at Godzilla. Like, just the vessel that gets torn up, mm-hmm. they obviously couldn't afford an industrial-sized tanker to just be sitting on the beach.
No.
So they constructed mm-hmm. one with computers, and
yes,
it's bad. It's very bad. Mm-hmm. It's... Like, even the MCU has some mm-hmm. shitty CGI, and I feel like it's not far off mm-hmm. from this.
No. And this is the thing, like, in the 90s, and this is not me defending the movie, because I'll get there in a bit. In the 90s, like, CGI was relatively new to movies and coming out and doing things. It's been around for a little bit. It's not great. And so you kind of understand, like when you see CGI in the 90s and you see it like, oh, they couldn't have done anything better than that. They couldn't have had a dude standing there with a sign or something. That would have looked more believable than that. So with this movie, it is odd that it's a big budget movie, and there are some scenes where the CGI isn't horrible. It's like, you know what? That's convincing. And even like watching it now, they're like, hey, you know what? Why didn't it, like in that one scene, it didn't look that bad. But then immediately 2 seconds later, oh, you know, yeah, it's bad. it's like, oh, it's bad again. It's just, it goes back and forth, and it mostly stays in the bad region. And it's just bizarre to me.
This CGI is like when your friend farts in a car and the windows are rolled up, and it first like, whoa, holy, that is awful. And then you're like, oh, okay, wait, no, it's okay. We can get
it wafted back in. Yep. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep.
It's like, oh shit. Yep. There it is again. Oh my God. And I'm going to completely agree with you on this, that like, yeah, I was watching this movie going, oh yeah, it looks pretty good for 98. Then I go, oh fuck, that is bad.
Oh no, it doesn't anymore. Yeah. It lost it right away.
That happened like four times just within this scene, looking at this boat. Mm-hmm. But one of the things that I actually have a bigger problem with is that when you look at a sci-fi film, even a disaster film, they're starting to put the pieces together. You got to at least make your experts sound like experts. And I don't quite understand. And maybe this is me. Maybe I have this wrong, Joe. But radiation wouldn't create a brand new species. It would just create a mutated species, wouldn't it?
Well, I mean, yes, it should. I mean, that's kind of been the thing, though, with like any weird radiation trope, like even like The Simpsons, like you get like the three-eyed fish that just becomes a, like more three-eyed fish, when really you should just have the three-eyed fish and then it dies horribly from radiation. so that is how it works. Although, I mean, like when you look at like early, I hate using like GMO at this point in time, because like when you say GMO, people are going to go straight to like, oh, everything's bad. And then I'm going to say like some ways that they did GMOs is they literally hit them with radiation, cause a genetic mutation, and then see if that mutation could actually spread, and see if they could get that mutation to be replicated when they would breed the thing. This is mostly with plants and labs, by the way. And then you would eventually get like a new breed or variant of it because they mutated it with radiation. Not to say that like the offspring are all radioactive. It's nope. The gene was mutated. When it replicated, it copied the mutated gene. It's not like just it's not going to be glowing green when you try and eat your food. So like it's something that's possible, but more than likely, I mean, the whole commentary with Godzilla being this mutated like mass, if you look at the original like guy in a costume Godzilla, the way they modeled the skin on Godzilla was to represent like the sores, the boils, and the mutations left on people when they were exposed to high amounts of radiation. So the whole idea that it made this giant lizard is a bit of a farce, but what the lizard looks like something that's been mutilated by radiation and is lashing out from it. And that was the point of the original monster. Mm-hmm. When we get to this, it's now just a really big, I was going to say disgruntled iguana, but as it turns out, it's a very big, paternally loving iguana who's doing all of this.
It just didn't feel believable. Anything they were really saying about this, though, especially when he goes like, it's a new species. And then like I'm like, why is that so crazy? That's not really like a huge revelation
here. Yeah.
Like you already saw a fucking footprint that's like 40 feet long. It's like, is that really a big reveal at that stage? We know what it is. We get it. Mm-hmm. You know? And so for me, it was like, okay, fine. If I'm wrong in the science, I'm wrong in the science, but I feel like I'm right on building up a little bit here. And absolutely, it just didn't feel like there was any rise to that. It was like, okay, no shit, no. Sherlock, what the fuck else you got?
No. And speaking of like no rise, one thing this movie does do is move really quick. And again, like you said, like there's not a lot of setup time, is that we have, okay, we're in Chernobyl with the worm guy. Then we're in, I think like Central America or the Caribbean, looking at footprints, and then boom, New York, baby.
Whoa.
Because that's where this is heading.
Mm-hmm. Hold the fuck up for a second. We're in the city that never sleeps, sir.
That's right.
They don't say New York on the little when they show the city graphic. It says the city that
the
never
city
sleeps.
That never sleeps.
Mm-hmm. And I sat there and I went, just fucking call it New York.
Is that necessary? Yeah, we don't need this.
What are you doing? What are you doing here? Come on, you know, like mm-hmm. I didn't wear the tracksuit on purpose, Joe. Being a I'm not a Northeastern mook here.
I did notice the lack of a gold chain tonight, so I didn't think that this was purposefully that kind of New York going on right now.
Well, to me, it felt like somebody took what they thought was the concept of New York and tried mm-hmm. to make it sound cool, as opposed to actually being New York, right? Like, because mm-hmm. literally 1989, Ghostbusters 2, I feel like they nailed New York and just like mm-hmm. miserable people living on top of miserable people. And then mm-hmm. we see little bits of positivity poke through. I feel like that's the city in a nutshell. Mm-hmm. This did not feel like New York to me, Joe. I mean, it just didn't.
Again, it's a character of New York where you've got people being mean who don't seem like they would be mean. Like our news anchor, who is clearly like, you know, coming on to Audrey Timmons and being a sexual just asshole.
That actually happened quite a bit.
Oh yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying that didn't happen, but I'm just saying like this is the toxic masculinity guy. Like this is who you have. You couldn't at least get like the sports guy who maybe has chiseled features and is like, yeah, I am your dream come true.
That's
like,
how they get you.
He's slimy.
Mm-hmm. Dude, Matt Lauer, he had literally like a sex dungeon for an office. I mean, come on.
It's true.
You never see this happening. But one thing mm-hmm. that did shock me right away, though, was that Godzilla's moving fast, got places to go.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Finds a dude who's fishing on a dock, on a pier. Somehow manages to snag Godzilla without his line breaking on his fishing pole. Mm-hmm. What kind of fucking line was he using on that thing?
I'm assuming diamond. Like, what else are you using? Like, that's not going to snap when you snag, you know, a 7-story monster in this case. Because, like Mark pointed out, this is a fast-moving Godzilla. And if you're aware of any Godzilla movie that is not Godzilla 98, he's not known for his speed. He moves really slow. He's just kind of like this force of nature that you know is coming. And like part of like the monster is like all you can really do is get out of his way. That's the point of him.
Oh, yeah.
And here we're like, no, we need a sleeker, sexier, faster Godzilla. Yeah. Yeah. The one that America wants.
yeah. Looks like a young man. once again, though, we've got this table setting that they're trying to do where mm-hmm. it's like, yes, large imposing force. People don't know that shit's about to go down. But then there's this weird thing that happens where suddenly we're introduced to like 4 or 5 different people mm-hmm. all wearing headphones. And suddenly, like, headphones apparently can block out vibrations felt across the earth.
Completely. Mm-hmm.
Had no idea that's what headphones do. No. We wear them during the podcast almost every week.
Yep, and I can still hear my dog angrily barking at oncoming traffic, like just going past my apartment. He's aware of it. He hates it. And I know it's happening. But on that note, this is one of the coolest scenes of the movie. For the few cool scenes, is when Godzilla first makes his presence known in New York City. And this is also part of the trailer. And again, like how we said that this movie is competing with Jurassic Park's sequel. Well, one of the biggest tropes that you recall, that you can maybe remember in Jurassic Park is before the T-Rex makes her appearance, you see Ian Malcolm's glass of water vibrating as it steps mm-hmm. through the ground. It's like, oh no, something big's coming, the water's shaking. Well, in this, people are sitting there drinking their coffee and suddenly their hand bounces up. As they're trying to do stuff, it zooms out to the city and you've got like officers standing, like waiting patrol. And then the ground shakes and they're moving up. Car alarms are going off. Vehicles are bouncing up and down and no one knows what the fuck is going on. And then like that again, that's like the hype is real. The monster's about to get to the screen. We're finally going to see him. And then we see him and it's like, what did we try doing here? What, this is the faster, sexier Godzilla you wanted to give me?
Dude, just straight up ghosts. I was sitting there going, okay, we've talked about this in a couple movies where let's not overexpose our villains, right? Let's not let people get too acquainted with it. And so I'm thinking to myself, smart decision, because I need Godzilla to stay imposing for a little bit. We can focus on the destruction of what Godzilla did and not focus on what Godzilla looks like just yet. Like, I'm like going, okay, you know what? Whether it's a CGI savings or whether it's just deliberate, I'm fine with that. But what I wasn't fine with was suddenly we've lost track of a 7 foot tall or 7 story tall beast on an island that frankly has 10 miles of visibility, even in full on, you know, snow and rain. And so it's like, okay. And that mother goes underground somehow. Like,
yeah, that's it. They lose him like 3 times in this movie. And at one point they do point out the ridiculousness of the whole thing over like, how did you lose 100 foot lizard? Like, how do you lose him? He's there. He's big. And they're like, we don't know. We don't know how we lost him, sir. It's we're inept and looking kind of comedically scared about it. And they kind of write it off. But this is also a time where I think I want to introduce something that I've been waiting to talk about ever since I suggested this movie. And that is the one thing about this that may be the movie being a little self-aware and being aware of, like, you know what? Maybe people aren't going to like this movie. And we just want to be like, you know what? Fuck you. We made a movie because we wanted to make a movie. And they do this through two characters, the mayor and his assistant, because it is Mayor Ebert and his assistant Gene.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Who are, of course, Roger Ebert and Gene Siskel, like two, at the time, like insanely popular critics. Like, Mark, if you remember, these two had a show where they just talked about movies they watched, if they liked them or not. And it was a half hour of these guys doing like, this is thumbs up or this is thumbs down. And this is, of course, Mayor Ebert's like big campaign things. He's always doing this, always doing this to the city. Just, Thumbs up. Here we go. We are going to get through this. And everything is thumbs up. He's constantly going for sweets. These characters, like Ebert, is thoroughly annoying. Siskel is mostly just sucking up to what Ebert is saying through most of the movie. And it's kind of a commentary, I think, maybe that's Emmerich's like commentary on, these are the people that are putting me down for making the movies that I want. I'm going to do that to them and not care. I'm going to make my movie that I want. And it was kind of bold, kind of interesting. What could have come off as actually funny, but like most things in this movie, fell short and was just obviously there and out of place.
Which is really how Godzilla feels when you finally do see Godzilla roughly about an hour into the movie. When you look at the previous films and how Godzilla existed in cinema before, yes, part of the campiness is the fact that you can tell it's someone in a suit, right? but that still looks more real than anything they tried accomplishing with CGI.
Oh, yeah.
The first time you see him, literally any type of fear they had built up or any kind of hype they had built up whittles away the second you see Godzilla for the first time. And God, it's Joe. The first time I saw Godzilla on screen, like I just was like, fuck, he made me watch this movie. He made me watch this movie. This is shit. What I'm seeing is pure shit right now. This is god awful, and it honestly just made me feel bad for Godzilla. Like, they did my boy dirty.
They did. That's the thing. Like, till my dying day, I will always defend that the best Godzilla is when it's a dude in a suit just stomping through a set. And part of it is the ridiculousness of it, is the fact that it is some guy stomping around in a suit, and whenever Mothra is flying by, at least 2 or 3 times in the movie, you can see the strings holding the giant moth up as it flies over things. But at the same time, you don't care. There's a message being delivered. There is a weird artistry that is, I don't want to say great artistry, there's an artistry to like someone crafting all of this, like the suit, the small city, the explosions, all of it seems like, even if it may come off corny, the effort to it is extreme. There's a love, there's a passion to it. And that is something that just kind of is completely absent in this movie. They gave us a sleeker, faster, smaller Godzilla in hopes of making him modernized or Americanized, of trying to make him, like, I don't know, like in some sort of weird way, kind of look scarier. And so they gave him this modern design that was just like, nope, this is what America wants, because this is what America wants. And like, even like the way this movie was hyped was very American and not like, God, because like, obviously like American indie independent cinema can, and even Hollywood can turn out some really, really good thought provoking pieces of art. But you know, a blockbuster is a blockbuster. And this is a blockbuster that was every second of it was intended to be a blockbuster. Hype it up, get people in the seats, make money, and then forget it ever happened the next day. And that's what kind of takes the passion out of these movies, out of this movie compared to the other Godzilla movies. Not to mention, I'm gonna do something that is, it's not a bold statement, and they take the god out of Godzilla in this, because Mark, I don't know if you've watched any of the older Godzilla movies, but like, he's swatting away planes like they're flies. Nothing really matters to him. He may be like, oh God, that stung. What the hell was that? And stomp on it and it's gone. Yeah. But this thing is running from every submarine. It's running. It's like, it's getting shot at by planes. It's like, oh shit, that really hurt. I better dig underground before it kills me. Not a single tank. I think, no, there are tanks in this movie. They shoot, but they miss the whole time. There are helicopters that don't remember that, you know, while they're flying through buildings with a giant lizard chasing them, they could just go up. They forgot that for some reason. And like, he's chasing down helicopters, and like that's the most scary he really is, other than like he's stomping through buildings. And I mean, obviously at the end of the movie is unlike most Godzilla movies, because the monster dies.
Plot twist.
Spoiler
and
alert.
Spoiler alert.
Twist.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Which, that was something I wanted to focus on too, because yes, usually when there's a massive beast in a movie and they do meet their demise, you're kind of like, all right, well, they did some bad things. Mm-hmm. Shit's going to suck. They're going to die. Fine. Yeah. I actually ended up feeling bad for Godzilla when Godzilla's kind of getting the death blow. I didn't miss the death blow, Joe. I saw it.
Mm-hmm.
And what's supposed to be like a triumphant moment for the heroes ends up being like a really sad and just depressing moment, because there's actually a very, well, I shouldn't say very well done, because there's very few things well done in this movie.
Yeah.
There's a decent sequence when you find out Godzilla's been laying eggs and they're trying to, you know, spread the species across the earth. And
he's a family man, Mark. Just wants to have a family and settle down. And in the city that never sleeps. It's a concrete jungle where dreams come true. And that's all he wanted, was to make it big. And he was killed for it.
But that's what sucks, is that you have the imagery of Godzilla seeing dead babies on the ground. And then you see it go on its rampage finally, right? And then you're like, you're going, fuck, I feel bad for Godzilla losing all of its kids, and now it goes out like that. It's like, shit.
Yeah.
It's like, this is just bad on top of bad, and now we're really making it bad. This is truly awful. What's going on with this character?
Again, to the credit I will give the movie, like, this is the one thing, this is one of the few things that it does do really right. When you look at Ishiro Honda, the original director of the first Godzilla movie, he's quoted as saying something similar to, because I might get a little wrong, saying that like, kaiju or giant monsters are tragic creatures. They're too big and too heavy for their own good, and they cause destruction wherever they go, and they end up dying for just living in the end of it all. And when you see Godzilla die in the original movie, it's not a pretty death. It's very, very painful for the monster, despite the fact he's literally just lashing out due to being disformed by radiation. When you have Godzilla die at the end of the Heisei era, he literally has absorbed so much radiation after, I believe it was an earthquake ruptured a nuclear facility in Japan, and he ended up absorbing too much too fast, and he's literally burning himself alive. And the entire movie is just him in pain, and you finally see him die in the end, and the humans are like, you know, in the end, he was just an animal, and he was just moving around, and we were trying to deal with him, and we hated him for the destruction he caused, but he was our fault in the first place. And you get that sense in this movie, in that he was created by us and basically our efforts to kill each other in war, and we created him, and tragically, all it was trying to do was live when we killed it. So I will agree with you, Mark, even more so, in that this is the good part of the movie that retains some of the theme that is usually present in every Godzilla movie.
Yeah, I did feel that part. I seriously did. Like, at the end of it all, I, for one, it did kind of make me forget about the fact that I had invested a little over an hour and a half into characters that frankly didn't really go anywhere. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then suddenly, just like every good 90s movie that I don't think mm-hmm. anyone really thought through, things just kind of end in a way that everybody wraps up and we're good. And we've got a little mm-hmm. bow on top of it. But the thing that I could not break from, Joe, was sitting there and going, is this a good movie?
Yeah.
Dude, are there people who actually watch this to be entertained? Mm-hmm. I have to ask you this because you made me watch it. Like, mm-hmm. what would keep people coming back to this movie, Joe?
And see, this is where it's difficult, because like season one, we reviewed Dread, a movie we absolutely love with Carl Urban. And then we decided, hey, you know what? It would be funny if we watched the silly piece of shit that Sylvester Stallone was in, just so we could make fun of it on the podcast. And then we watched it and we were like, you know what? It wasn't as bad as we remembered. It was comic booky. It was cheesy. It was actually a really good paced movie. Good amount of action. You have Stallone being Stallone. Rob Schneider's funny. You got the lovely Diane Lane there, actually bringing the acting up a notch. And it worked. It somehow worked way better than I remembered. And I was hoping that would happen again. But it didn't. It didn't at all. This was literally me going like, you know what? Let's see if we can do lightning in a bottle again, and we'll do it with Godzilla, because I remember being a kid and absolutely falling in love with Godzilla, not in a weird, strange way, but like, this is just a cool concept. I love the idea. I love the giant like guy in a suit like going on. And then I got my hopes up for this movie and I saw it and I'm like, he doesn't even breathe fire. Like, he doesn't do the Godzilla things. Like, he's just like, It's not what I was expecting, and it wasn't even that great. Like, I had toys. I had all the Taco Bell cups and the weird cup holder that was, like, you could put in a window, and, like, your cup would go in it, because for some reason your car, actually, it was the 90s, there weren't cup holders in everything. And when there were, there wasn't a guarantee that there was enough for everyone, so that made sense at the time. But like, I remember going into it thinking, this is going to be great. Even my friends like, hey, you know what? That Godzilla movie does look good. Maybe this weird kid who likes the Japanese monster movie has something, like, maybe he's onto something. And they saw it and they're like, nah, he's just an idiot who likes the Japanese monster movie. So I was hoping that, you know, as an adult, maybe I would see what the filmmakers were really trying to accomplish. And in the end, I saw like some fleeting moments of like, where I'm guessing Toho came in, the company that owns the rights to Godzilla, who obviously gave some rights to Columbia TriStar to make this movie, said like, hey, if you're making a Godzilla movie, you have to have this theme in there prevalent somewhere, which is why we get the sad animal in the end. But then everything else, it was a blockbuster. It was a movie for the sake of being a movie. And it's what I said, I think is that's its legacy, is it's something that's made that in a lot of cases is kind of meant to be forgotten by us. And even Toho has tried completely distancing themselves from this movie, where they actually fully bought the rights to the Columbia TriStar Godzilla, lobbed the god off, and just referred to the monster as Zilla. and had it show up in a movie they called Godzilla Final Wars, where Godzilla is going around killing all of the other giant monsters, and the alien and an alien tries, like, at the last second, like, hey, this is my trump card, throws out Zilla to fight Godzilla, and it literally gets taken out in like a second. And it's their commentary, like, yeah, that was a bad movie. So, but what do you think, Mark, as someone who had to watch this for the first time in 2023, many years after 1998?
I think it's just a failed attempt at combining elements that worked for a lot of the 90s action movies. Mm-hmm. You know, like, there's certain things you can call out, like in Jurassic Park, where we have the kitchen sequence where the velociraptors mm-hmm. are hunting. It's very tense, very creepy. It's hard to get through. And they tried to do a little bit of that with, like, the baby Godzillas mm-hmm. and all that. I was like, okay, yep, I can see what they did here. Then mm-hmm. you've got the buildup of a lot of these disaster movies. And I know that Emmerich was also involved with Independence Day. They tried to do a very similar lead up where it's like, okay, we've got some little elements here. We're kind of building, we're getting some clues. And so that's what I kept doing when I was watching this, is going, I've seen this movie before.
Mm-hmm.
It may not have been a massive radioactive monster that was the source of everything, but it was a very similar style of, like, Independence Day movie.
Yeah.
I think it, unfortunately, it fails as a Godzilla movie. Mm-hmm. And it's not fleshed out. It really isn't fleshed out in any way. It feels like a choose your adventure book if mm-hmm. they ripped out, like, half the choices. And
it was all the good choices.
yeah.
Mm-hmm. They took all those out.
And that's really what it kind of left me with, Joe, was really mm-hmm. feeling disappointment for something that I thought I was thinking kind of the same thing, not with like Judge Dredd, but I was thinking I could probably find something good in this or something that mm-hmm. I would want to return to. Unfortunately, no. I will never return to this movie.
No.
I will never watch it again. Mm-mm. It was that bad.
Yeah. And it's unfortunate, because the only thing it gets right is the tragedy of it all. But by the time you see the tragedy, you're just mad at the rest of the movie. And now it's like, oh, wow, it turns out this was an innocent lizard trying to do its life, and we were the assholes. Oh, fuck. It turns out I wasted my time watching this movie. And that's kind of what it feels like in the end. And when this thing is, again, like, it's not even like firing warning shots at the Spielberg camp with what it was trying to say about, like, the lost world. It was just full on, like, shooting right at the ship. And mm-hmm. that is a tall order when you consider, like, you can go back and watch not Jurassic World, the original Jurassic Park from 1993. And even though we know they're inaccurate, holy fuck, do the dinosaurs look real. And that's 1993. Fucking three. And like, you got to think, like, who sold their soul at a crossroads to make this work as well as it did? Like, there's those things have no business. The animatronics, the CGI, none of it should look as good as it does for 1993. And I hate having that as an asterisk, because you can watch it now and be like, hey, that's good, that holds up. You can watch Jurassic Park and never for a moment get taken out of the movie because of the CGI or the animatronics. And that is 5 years before this movie. And I can guarantee you that Jurassic Park, The Lost World, didn't regress in its graphics for the animals in that movie. It still worked perfectly. And you could maybe argue that that's maybe scale, because even though a T-Rex is really big, building an animatronic T-Rex is bigger than building, you know, Godzilla and having him work and flesh out in the environment. But I would never actually use that as an excuse. It's like, no, you could have done better, and you know you could have done better, and you didn't. And that's what's disappointing.
Guess what? We may not return to Godzilla 1998 ever again, but we do hope you return to Digital Dissection in the future. We do thank you for listening to us. And as always, we appreciate everything our dissection crew does for us week after week. Your support does go an incredibly long way, much further than Godzilla CGI could ever go. And if you happened upon this show by accident, why not drop us a review, comment on the show, maybe ask me if I've ever thought about using hymns for my hairline? I'm not offended, okay? So seriously, let us know what you think.
Because we really do love hearing from you, and any commentary you do on our shorts, on our Facebook page, on Instagram, anything you have to say to us and what we're doing, really, really feels good. And you know, if you even email us, please don't use any of our personal emails that we don't give out, and we don't know how you got them, but stop. You know who you are. It was kind of funny for a while, but it's over. Instead, email us at digitaldissectionpodcast@gmail.com, where we do welcome your ideas for movies, shows, video games, anything that you'd like to hear us talk about. And if you are going to pick a movie and you thought it might be bad when you were younger, and maybe it hits different now, please give us a heads up on that first before we do this to ourselves again. And on that note, until next time, keep on dissecting.